Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. In the future, the land of Israel has been refurbished from the destruction of wars. The natural beauty of the countryside has been restored, the inhabitants are secure, and there are no threats from the surrounding nations. Then, at the end of the millennial kingdom, Gog and his armies will come like a storm from the north, east, south, and west to invade Israel and attack Jesus. Modern Israel is replete with checkpoints and walls, homes are heavily fortified, and there is no way to reconcile Ezekiel's description of the promised land with what exists today, because these events take place in the future. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And we're going to be talking today about something in the future, Gog's army. And if you have a Bible, I'm going to start in Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 and 3. So that Genesis chapter 2, 1 and 3 is where we're going to start. So let me just pray. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you right now for anointing this sermon, helping to deliver it in such a way, Father God, that it bring glory to you, people will be convicted, we will change our lives. And I thank and I praise you for that now. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, the Godhead paused the virtual time run as we look upon a virtual time run again. God the Father had previously stated he would prove his righteousness over the course of 14 days. 7 days had been used to refurbish the earth and set up Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Lucifer would be provided with 6 days to do his work and try to prove that he is right. As I've been studying, I'm writing a book right now called The World That Was. And I have done a deeper study into Genesis, the beginning, and into a number of different scriptures in the Bible. And we find in Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 and 3 here. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and the whole host of them. And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. In Genesis chapter 1, it says that God had worked for 6 days. Well, if it is a regular 24-hour day, there's not a whole lot you can do with 24 hours. And so it has been debated by the creationists that really believe how that God created. They simply said, no, there was 24-hour periods. But the Holy Spirit revealed to the Apostle Peter that 1,000 years for us is 1 day for the Lord. And so what I've done is simply this. I realized that each day in chapter 1 is 1,000 years. I have read this many times before, and you know, on the seventh day God rested, you know, and I didn't pay attention. But Adam and Eve were created on the sixth day. The animals also were created on the 6 days in the morning, and Adam and Eve later. That means that Adam and Eve lived for 1,000 years in the Garden of Eden, the day of rest, the seventh day. On the outline here, We have 2 Peter 3:8, and I'll read that to you. That's 2 Peter 3:8. One day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The revelation to Peter was fulfillment of God's promise to Daniel, effectively allowing us to convert eternity time into earthly time. And just for the record of it, let's read here from 2 Peter. And we get to it, 2 Peter. And we're going to go to chapter 3, verse number 8. But beloved, be not ignorant. That's a strong statement. Ignorant, stupid, uninformed. Peter writes, but beloved, be not ignorant, stupid, uninformed of this one thing, that one day is for the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. As I studied this in the Genesis, and I realized that there's a pattern. We have 7 days, 6 days of creation, or 6,000 years of creation. Then we have one day, 1,000 years of rest. And who comes up after the end of the seventh day, the 1,000 years here? Lucifer, Satan. And what does he do? He comes in the garden to tempt Adam and Eve. He starts with Eve, and Eve takes down Adam. If we do not know that from the time Adam and Eve fell into sin, we are now 6,000 years later. That's 6 days. We are not fully 6 days. We are in the 6 days after Adam and Eve were created. And then we read in the book of Revelation about the 1,000-year kingdom. That means 6 days, then comes the seventh day in this cycle, the 1,000-year kingdom, and after the 1,000 years, who shows up? Lucifer, to tempt the people born during 1,000 years. In my new book, The World That Was, I've written quite a bit about this and explained it much more. But what I want you to understand is simply this. As we're coming down to the end time, God is beginning to reveal to us more. All the information that I share with you here has existed since it was written down. There's nothing new. I don't have a new revelation. I haven't had a revelation where an angel came down and simply said, okay, we're going to give you a revelation. No, I just had a revelation from the Word. It's like God opened up the Word to me and showed me a pattern. 7 days, 7 days, a total of 14 days. That we are in this situation. Lucifer is going to have an antichrist. And if you turn to Revelation 17:10, that's Revelation 17:10, we are given a timeline here. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue as a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even his eighth, and is of the seven that goes into perdition. And the ten horns which you saw are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast. That tells me that the Antichrist is going to reign for 1 hour, which, if we use the conversion here, is 41.67 years. Most people in churches today, that says, well, the tribulation period is 7 years, and you know, we got a half time in there and so on. Well, there's no place in the Bible where it says that there's a 7 year period. We don't have that. But we do have here 1 hour, and we do know the conversion. If you look on the outline there, at the end of the sixth day, Jesus will return to earth and destroy Lucifer's federation and bind it for 1,000 years, or one day for heaven, and cast him into the bottomless abyss. Now the devil was allowed to tempt Adam and Eve at the end of the seventh day, and in like manner, Satan will be set free to tempt all the people born during the millennial reign of Jesus on the seventh day. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 20 and read verses 7 and 9. That's chapter 20, 7 and 9. And when 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to get them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. 1,000 years, people lived for 1,000 years. There's no sickness during the 1,000 years, which means that couple gets married 20, 22 years old, have children, and they continue to have children for 1,000 years. Their children, in turn, get married. They have children. It could explode. It could be an explosion of population explosion. So now, the question is asked, now why is this happening? Because the devil is bound during a 1,000-year kingdom. And we read this here in chapter 20, verse number 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, shut him up, set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nation no more, till 1,000 years should be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. In order to be saved, there's got to be a counterforce. So people born during the 1,000-year kingdom are not going to be saved, but the devil is bound. Demons are not working, which means that people are going to be fairly decent, but they're not saved. And at the end, Satan will come up, because every one of us had to make a choice. And just like you have in a courtroom, you have a prosecutor, you have a defense attorney. Satan is the prosecutor. He's the accuser. If he's not around, you can't make a decision. The sad thing is, when 1,000 years are up, people that lived on earth in prosperity, Jesus had been ruling out of Jerusalem, no sickness, full employment, climate that's perfect. When Lucifer comes up, he will deceive the majority of the people that were born during the 1,000-year kingdom. And they would say, well, we got Jesus here, we had a nice time. But Lucifer is promised us some exciting things. What did he promise Eve? You eat of that, you become like gods, angels. The human race, we are evil to begin with. We have a streak in us. We have the sinful nature. And you know what? It doesn't take a whole lot to bring out the ugliness in man. I don't care. Married couples, single people. You know, as long as no one challenges you, everything is hunky-dory. Oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Glory to God. But when you are challenged, when things are not going your way, guess who shows up? Lucifer shows up with his demons. And before you know it, you sound like a sewer pipe that is just spewing it out. And then afterward you said, that was not too good. No, it was not too good. We need to learn to control ourselves and recognize if I'm challenged, I don't have to prove anything to anyone. I'm not going to get my cage rattled. We're going to pray. We're going to have the Holy Spirit speak to us. We're going to do this in peace and harmony. It's sad. The human race is a sad situation. And of course, I'm one of them. Now, this leads, on the page one here on the outline, this leads to the great white throne judgment where Jesus will judge everyone kept in hell. Those names not found in the book of life will be cast in the lake of fire prepared for the devil and fallen angels. And in Revelation chapter 20, verse number 11, we read this. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whom face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of the things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Most people don't take this seriously. But I want you to understand this. If a person has not accepted Christ, has not been born when they lived on this earth, they will be cast into the lake of fire. Church membership cannot save. Good works cannot save. Being a nice person cannot save. When a baby is born in this earth, that baby is condemned to death He has a sinful nature. And by default, people will end up in hell, like in the lake of fire. If the Christians really believed this, you would be much more aggressive in witnessing. If you have somebody in your family that's not saved, you would be much more aggressive and say this. Do you realize that right now we might be married? I'm saved, but you're not. When you die, you're going to go to hell. I'm going to go to heaven. We're going to be separated. Is that what you want? But we don't say that because we really don't believe it. It is sad. Page 2 on the outline. Ezekiel's prophecy would serve as a warning to the people who would be alive during this time period so they could make an informed decision as to whether or not they would want to join Lucifer. So let me ask you this. You says, well, the book of Ezekiel is hard to understand. It's prophecy against this, prophecy against this, and so on. You know, if God put it in the Bible, let me repeat that. If God put Ezekiel in the Bible, he did that because he wants you to read it. Every book in the Bible is important. It's there for a purpose. Now, we pick and choose what we like, but there's something to learn from every book. Let's look at a prophecy now. When we do that, turn back to Ezekiel, chapter 38. That's Ezekiel, the 38th chapter. And so we want to learn a couple of things here. In order for you to understand, when he said east, north, and south, and so on, they're not talking about America. They're not talking about Washington, D.C. They talk about Jerusalem. Every time there is a reference to north, south, east, west, it's from the point of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is point zero. That's where everything in the Bible is measured from. Now, there are a lot of nations surrounding Jerusalem, and Gog is going to marshal forces to converge on Israel from the south, west, east, and the north. I believe that Gog is the archon over Russia with a vast territory stretching from the Baltic Sea to the Pacific Ocean. We have seen Putin. Putin is demon-possessed. Remember this. Archons, fallen angels, are in charge of every nation. They don't age. They don't grow old. They don't change. The same fallen angel that was in charge of Persia at the time of Daniel is still there. You can see Persia today, or Iran, is a very hostile nation. The people are nice, but the mullahs are terrible, and they have a religion, and they are simply lunatics, the leadership, and they're taking the people with them. The archons that was over Greece is still there. The archons have not moved. So if you go back and read in the Bible and then think about what these fallen angels did, you can predict what they're doing today. You can see this of Russia. Russia, vast, goes from the Pacific all the way to the Baltic Sea. And Putin, controlled by Gog, is simply not satisfied. Let me just say about the Ukraine for just a couple of minutes. In 1990, Yeltsin, and a number of other Russian leadership, these are communist leadership, met. And they simply said this: it is obvious that the Soviet Union is falling apart. They were financially corrupt. So they simply said, this is what we're going to do. The Soviet Union has had some number of nations that they have conquered. We're going to break it up. And we're going to give each nation freedom to do whatever they want. You had the Baltic countries broke away. You had all the Stan countries broke away. And Ukraine broke away and were considered a different country. Belarus, which is White Russia, they pulled away. And what you had left was Russia. And that's how it was in 1991, 92, when the Soviet Union broke up. And it was fine for more than 20 years, less than 20 years, until Putin decided that this is not good. It was a disaster when they broke up the Soviet Union. This is Gog simply saying, no, I don't like this. I had all these countries together, I was ruling them, and now they broke up. I want it back. That's why we got the war in Ukraine. That's why there's going to be more wars. In Ezekiel chapter 38, verses 1 and 2, now we read this. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set your face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach, Tubal, and prophesy against him. And say, thus is the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. I believe this referred to Russia. This prophecy now is past the tribulation. This prophecy now is past 1,000 years. So we do know that when the Antichrist comes, there's going to be a lot of people are going to be killed off at Armageddon. There's going to be judgments on the earth. But there are people in Russia that will survive. There are people in America that will survive. The nations will have remnants. Some of them have not taken the mark of the beast. And they would come alive into the 1,000-year kingdom. At the end of the 1,000-year kingdom, they are multiplied as the sand of the sea. Gog is sitting over that geographical area. There's generations to come that will be born that he would entice to attack Israel and Jesus Christ himself. We're going to go back to Ezekiel here, so just quickly turn to Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10, where we have the information here. So in Daniel chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, then said he, that's the angel unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself before your God, your works were heard, and I am come for your words. The angel said, the first day that you prayed, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit said, hey, to this angel here, go down and talk to Daniel. But now verse 13, but a prince of the kingdom of Persia, that's the oracle, as the fallen angel, which stood me 120 days, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. It took 21 days to break the grip of the prince of Persia so the angel could come. In the same chapter, 9, verse number 20, he says, then said, know you were, therefore I come unto you. Now I will return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I'm gone forth, though the prince of Greece shall come, the archon of Greece is going to come. So, as a Christian, understand this. Over America is a fallen angel. He resides over Washington, D.C. He has lesser fallen angels under him, and he has a lot of demons. And they are simply trying to rule this nation. They try to rule Canada. There's an archon over Canada. There's an archon over Mexico. Everywhere do we have these fallen angels doing nothing but destruction. In my outline, I said this. It is my belief there's a fallen angel archon that's in charge of each nation throughout the world. Each one's job is to carry out Lucifer's orders. Under the archons are less powerful fallen angels, and under them are evil spirits, demons of different ranks. Let's turn to Ephesians right now. That's the book of Ephesians. And we're going to go to, let me get to it here. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 11. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. In other words, we need the armor of God upon us. Because every day, the devil tells his fallen angels to tell the demons, harass you. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So you understand that we are physically, we live in the physical world, but there's a spirit world, and the spirit world has come to us. And Satan is simply saying this, I want to rule your life. I want to direct your path. He can only be in one place at one time. So he's using other fallen angels to supervise the nations. Under these archons are lesser fallen angels supervising regions, and under them are the foot soldiers, the evil spirits of the demons. They are everywhere, working 24/7. They never sleep. They don't age. They've been at it for more than 6,000 years. And you and I are rookies. Unless we stand upon the word of God, we will fall. Let's talk about Lucifer's trial here. And I'm giving you some background studies here today as we understand the prophecy. If a Christian is not familiar with the biblical teaching that Lucifer rebelled against God before Adam and Eve were created, it is impossible to comprehend Ezekiel's prophecy in conjunction with the Apostle John's revelation. In our court system in the United States, we have superior courts. We then have appellate courts. Then we have a Supreme Court in each state. We have federal courts, appellate courts, Finally, we have a Supreme Court in Washington, D.C. The laws are simply saying this. This is how it should be. That a person is innocent until proven guilty. Let me run this by you right now so you don't go in here and one there, you know, so I don't know what you're talking about. I came from Sweden. Sweden has a total different setup. So do they have in Germany and in other countries. In Sweden, it is up to you to prove that you are innocent. In other words, when you are arrested, it is assumed that you are guilty. And the arrested person has to get a defense lawyer and prove I am not guilty. In the United States, it's the opposite. If a person is arrested, he's considered innocent until after the trial. And if he's found guilty at the trial, then he is pronounced being guilty. You see the difference? It's a big difference. We are blessed in the United States. If you are arrested, you can say, but you know, I'm innocent. Prove that I'm guilty. In Sweden, they simply said, you are arrested, you go to the clink, and you prove that you are innocent. We consider you guilty. That's how Satan works. He considers you guilty. And he will do all that he can. Now, Satan rebelled against God, and I got very limited time here today because I want to get into the prophecy. So what I'm going to do is, I've preached this before, but I'm going to go through the points and tell you about it. In Isaiah chapter 14, 12, and 21, and also in Jeremiah chapter 28, we have the description of Lucifer rebelling against God. The description there is that before Adam and Eve lived and were created, there were angel civilizations. Lucifer was a regent of the earth. He had nations, cities. There were people here. And he decided to rebel and simply say, I do not want to serve God. I want to be like God. And he started a war. I am going to read Revelation 12. That's Revelation chapter 12. So these scriptures you have to look up yourself. Revelation chapter 12. And we're going to go to verse number 7. Let me say this quickly. Revelation is not a story from A to Z. It's many stories. Chapter 12 has many different prophetic revelations. It is not just one, it's several. If you read it as one, you get lost. In verse number 7, it says, and there was war in heaven. That means the universe. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon fought and his angels. Yes, they are UFOs. They are crafts. Angels have crafts. We read it in the Bible. Lucifer had craft. There was a horrible war that went from solar system to solar system. From galaxy to galaxy. We don't know how long that war took place. But Michael chased down Lucifer and his fallen angels. And they fought and fought and fought and finally drove them down to the earth. And this is where he was captured. You want to have a picture of it? Picture World War II, the Pacific, as the United States fought from island to island to island and finally got to Japan. And it says in verse 8, and prevail not, neither was there place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world. He was cast into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of God, and the power of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony. They loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens. There are angels out there. There are civilizations. Rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil has come down to you having great wrath, because he knows that he has but a short time. So this is where we're at. There was a war. There was a trial. In Matthew 25:41, I'm not going to read it right now, but you have it in Matthew 25:41. It says, and Satan and his fallen angels were sentenced to the lake of fire. The lake of fire was made for them. That means there was a trial. The next point is this. Logic would dictate that it was a trial and guilty verdict was issued, but Satan is still on the earth. He must have appealed the decision and received a stay of execution. Paul's letter to the Romans tells us that God is proving his righteousness. Let's turn to Romans chapter 3. That's Romans, the third chapter. And I'm going fast, so you're going to have to study this by yourself. You got the outline, you got the verses. In Romans 3:23, we read this. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, to the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that's God's righteousness, that he might be just and the justice of him which believes in Jesus. So here's a shortcut. Lucifer, after he was sentenced to the lake of fire, simply said, I appeal. How can a God send his creatures into everlasting punishment? That is unjust. All the angels heard it, good and bad. And God stood accused of being unrighteous. And at that moment, God said, I will prove my righteousness. I will prove I'm righteous. That's why Adam and Eve were created. That's why you and I live. We are proving God's righteousness. When you accept Christ, you are proving to the angels, yes, I'm a sinner. Yes, I'm repenting. Yes, I receive forgiveness. I receive it, and I'm saved. That shows the angels that we, by a free will, go to God and ask for forgiveness, and we are forgiven. Every time a person is saved, it shows to the angels that God is righteous. If a person says, I don't want Jesus, I don't want anything to do with them. They die and go to hell. It's on them, not on God. Then back to the outline again. We know there's a courthouse in the spirit world. There's a courthouse out there. If you read Job chapter 1, Job chapter 2, it talks about the courthouse where Satan comes all the time and lodges accusations. Lucifer appealed his sentence to the lake of fire and accused God of being unrighteous. God responded by creating Adam and Eve to prove his righteous, while Lucifer is doing all he can to undermine and sabotage God's plan for the human race. Page 3. In order to ace out Lucifer, so he could not tamper with the redemption of mankind, God had to hide the redemption plan. I want to spend a little bit of time on that. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 2. First Corinthians chapter 2, I'm going to read verses 6 and 8. Howbeit, we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor are the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in the mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world into our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Notice that last verse. If Satan would have known that Jesus was going to be on the cross, that God was going to put all the sins on him, he was going to pay for that on the cross. If Satan would have known that, guess what? The Jews would have not said, crucify him. Pontius Pilate would have not said, take him to and crucify him. Satan would have simply said to his fallen angels, to all the demons, you see Jesus coming down there? Protect him. Make sure he doesn't die. Make sure he dies of old age. But whatever you do, don't get him near a cross. So God simply said, this is something that will be hidden. And if you read in the Old Testament, it says we have the Messiah coming. He was going to pay for the sins, but it doesn't tell us how. So this is how God aced him out. Now let's go down to the prophecy of Ezekiel here, chapter 38. So, at this time, when this prophecy was given, Satan did not know about the cross. He didn't know about the payment. And so God is simply saying there, this is what's going to happen in the future. And I want you to know it in advance. This has nothing to do with salvation. This has to do with the future. Has Satan read this? Yes. Does Satan know this? Yes. Does Satan believe this? No. If he believed it, he wouldn't even talk to God and say, you know, do this or that. You got to understand, Satan is like a criminal. A criminal planned to break into your house. In his mind, he will prevail. He doesn't know that you have weapons. He doesn't know that by the time he kicks in the door, you start shooting. And he has to flee. He doesn't know that. So remember this. Satan doesn't believe what God said. And most preachers do not believe what God said. They agree with the devil. Now, verses 3 and 6 in Ezekiel chapter 38. And say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I'm against you, Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. I will turn you back and put hooks into your jaws. I will bring you forth and all your army, horses and horsemen, all them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all them handling swords. Persia, Ethiopia, and Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet, Gomer and all his bands, the house of Togarmah of the north quarters, and all his bands, and many people with you. Be you prepared, and prepare for yourself, you and all your company, that I assemble unto you, and be you a guard unto them. Being a guard means that God has captured these other nations. He controls them. So at the very end here now, in 1,000 years, this is what's going to happen. God's armies will come like a storm, having evil thoughts in his mind from Lucifer, who has been traveling all over the earth to make ready for a last attack of Jesus and his government in Jerusalem. Verses 9 and 10. You shall ascend and come like a storm. You shall be like a cloud to cover the land, you and all your bands and many people with you. Thus is the Lord God. It shall also come to pass that at the same time shall things come into your mind, and you shall think an evil thought. Keep your finger here now and turn to Revelation chapter 20. That's Revelation chapter 20. And you pick it up in verses 7 and 8. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. Catch this now. In the book of Revelation, God is simply saying, Jesus revealed this to the Apostle John. This is going to happen. Now, in Ezekiel, in the book of Ezekiel, we are told how the war is going to be. Let me run that by you again. God spoke to Ezekiel about 590 B.C. and said, right there, it's going to be a future war, Gog and Magog. It's going to be toward the end, latter days. That's all Ezekiel knew. He wrote it down. Okay? Now, it's been a number of years since that time. More than 2,600 years. In Revelation now, we are told this is when it will happen. But in Revelation, it is not detailed the war. So to understand the last war, you got to read Ezekiel and the book of Revelation to understand what's going to go down at that particular time. Back to your outline, now we're going to talk about unwalled cities and no gates. If we look now in verse 11, I'm back in Ezekiel chapter 38 now. And you shall say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls, having neither bars nor gates. When Ezekiel got this prophecy, it is a matter of it was in Babylon, it was in Israel, it was in Greece, Rome, whatever it was. Every city had walls. Every village had walls. There was constant warfare. And now, God tells Ezekiel, when this is going to happen, when they're going to attack the land of Israel, those people living there are going to be unprepared. They're not going to have any walls. They're not going to have any gates. Verse 12, to take a spoil, to take a prey, to turn your hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, upon the people that are gathered out of the nations with their gotten cattle and goods that dwell in the midst of the land. The description here that you have now is simply this. Israel, at this time, this will be a thousand-year kingdom. Jesus will be in Jerusalem, reigning over the world. King David is going to reign over the Jews there. There's going to be no wars. They're going to have no military might. There's peace for a thousand years. And now, God simply says, this is the time to attack. In verse number 14, therefore, son of man prophesied and said to Gog, thus is the Lord God, in that day when my people of Israel dwell safely, shall you not know it? Are Jewish people living safely in Israel today? No. Just last night, there was a man that shot up 9 people in Jerusalem. Every day there is violence. There's war between them and the Palestinians, between the Iranians. There's no peace. Let me read again. Therefore, son of man prophesied and said to Gog, thus says the Lord God, in that day, when my people of Israel dwell safely, shall you not know it? And you shall come from your place out of the north parts, you and many people with you, all riding upon horses, a great company, a mighty army. And you shall come up against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. It shall be in the latter days. Notice that. It shall be in the latter days. I will bring you against my land that the heathen may know me when I shall be sanctified in you, O God, before their eyes. So, God simply said, this will happen when there is peace. This means that the prophecy of Ezekiel cannot be put to today's Israel. Today's Israel is pre-Antichrist. Israel was created by the sword. The Holy Spirit did not create the political state of Israel. Man did. This is referring to at the end of the thousand years. And then God says this in verse number 18. And it shall come to pass at the same time when Gog should come against the land, Israel, says the Lord God, that my fury shall come up in my face. For in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shake in the land of Israel. And then, verse number 22, and I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood. I will rain upon him and upon his bands and upon the many people that are with him, overflowing rain and great hailstone, fire and brimstone. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself. And I'll be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Closing here now, I want to say this. In the last two verses I just read, God said, I'm going to destroy Gog, Magog, all the people coming. I'm going to wipe them out. Satan does not believe that. The fallen angels do not believe that. They realize there's going to be a thousand-year kingdom. They read the Bible. I mean, Satan reads the Bible. He knows every verse. But he thinks this. It's going to be different. I will be able to defeat Jesus. Do you understand what I said earlier today? Christians will say, oh, I don't believe in these prophecies. I don't believe it's true. You are agreeing with the devil. It will happen. Satan will be defeated. He will come to an end. And next week, we can discuss how the war is going to go. And I'm going to talk to you about the judgment seat, the great white throne judgment, after the war is over. What can we learn of this now? Learn this. Man is sinful. Look at yourself and simply ask this. Am I one person in public? Another person at the job, another person at home? Or are you the same person that you are in church? The sad thing is that most Christians today are two-faced. We have two personalities. We have one personality towards strangers and to people in the world. We want them to think highly of us. We talk nice. We behave well. But when we are home, or when we're with a family, we let it rip. And we act like demons, maniacs. And then we wonder, you know, why is God not blessing me? I don't hear from God. Well, if we are knuckleheads, he's not going to talk to us. If you got a child that's disobedient, and you just had spanked that child, and the child is simply saying, okay, Dad, I want some ice cream. Dad's going to say, you want ice cream? I'm going to give you another whacker. Go to your room. I'm mad. I'm punishing you. That's what God does. So if we read about this here, we can see that all these people are lining up with Satan. This is what, I'm not going to, if I've lived there, but we are going to live during this time because we're going to be resurrected. But you know what? How do you live today? If you cannot live for Jesus today, he's not going to use you in a thousand-year kingdom. He's not going to give you a nice job in a thousand-year kingdom. He's going to simply say, hey, you clean the streets. You dig the ditches. You misbehaved. I don't like your behavior. So we talk about prophecy. It's going to be bad. But I want you to think about this. How are you? You know, if somebody would come and ask your children this, how are your mom and dad? Well, we don't want to talk about that. Do they ever argue? We don't want to talk about that. We don't want to talk about what's going on at home. But if they talk, they can say, yeah, Dad, you know, they argue from time to time. It gets pretty ugly. There's not a family on this planet that is perfect. To have a perfect family, you got to work for it. And you got to make a decision that you are not going to be two-faced. You're going to be the same to your wife, to your husband, as you are to your boss, to the people you meet in the street. You're going to be the same as when you go to church. When you walk into church with your big Bible, I got a big Bible. And you go, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And little Johnny says, he didn't talk like that at home. It's F this or F that. What was going on, Dad? We're in church, son. In church, we behave. You got to learn, son. It shouldn't be like that. But that's the way it is. And you know, I talk to people, I counsel people, I share with them, I preach, I do my best. And people says, oh, that was a great sermon. Yeah, I just can't remember what he talked about, but he was great. Sometimes, that's why I don't have too much hair in the back here. I tear it out. So, closing. If you're not saved, and you simply say this, I want to be saved today. I want to get in. Beautiful. Here's what you do. Confess you're a sinner. You know that. Ask God to begin to forgive you. Then say this, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross. I believe he paid for my sins. Jesus, come on in and save me. Forgive me. Cleanse me. I want to be saved. You do that, and Jesus is going to come. We got some more good news for you. When we finish here, the screen will change on your computer or your television set. Three crosses will come up, and you will hear the voice of Pastor Charles saying, my friend. And then he will take you through the steps of salvation. About 10 minutes of your life. And help you to understand what you need to do. What about if you are a Christian now? And by the way, when you get saved, would you contact us? Let us know, because we'd like to help you out, pray with you, encourage you. But to those of you that are walking with Christ, like I said, every Sunday I say the same thing. Some of you are about ready to go to heaven. You are sanctified, ready, packed to go. You have got things under control. And then you got a sliding scale down here to the person down here with the F-bombs. And so what you want to do is this. Instead of sliding down the scale, you want to walk up the scale. So take an inventory of your life and simply say, God, what do I need to improve? What can I do? What kind of dirt do I have in my life? And once you see the dirt, don't let it lay there. Take care of it. Repent. Ask God to help you. And ask the Holy Spirit to wash out your mouth so that it comes out sweet stuff and not like you haven't brushed your teeth for 3 weeks and you smell like you know what. So with that, it's up to you. I'm just your coach. I'm just telling you what needs to be done. I bring it out from the Bible, and it's up to you to act upon it. May God bless you, and here is Soteros to close.
Thank you, Lord. Let no corrupt communication shall proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may bring grace unto the hearers. And we want to thank you, praise you, Heavenly Father, for the message, O Lord. Let, O Lord, study it more and more, meditate upon this, and start practicing it. And we want to thank you and praise you, Heavenly Father, for glory, for helping us, O Lord, to our lives to be straightened out. And we want to thank you and praise you, Heavenly Father, that we can do all things through Christ which strengthened us, in the name of Jesus. Let this warning, O Lord, go throughout the country, and people realize the things that they need to change, the things that they need to correct, that they can be used and be profitable. And we want to thank you, praise you, Heavenly Father, for making a way where there seems to be no way. And we bless you, Lord, and love you, Lord, and love you. Oh, thank you, Heavenly Father, that let us take heed, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Oh, and let us stand. And let no corrupt communication proceed out of our mouth, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Let us be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as we know, our labor is not in vain in the Lord. Thank you, Father, for touching the pastor, for anointing him mightily, O Lord, today, and giving us a message that we all need to hear. We all need to, O Lord, to meditate upon this, and O Lord, and be able to practice it. And we give you all the praise, Lord, all the glory, all the honor. I pray this in Jesus' precious and mighty name. And all God's children said, amen and amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life.
Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 78th part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, Gog's Army. In the future, the land of Israel has been refurbished from the destruction of wars. The natural beauty of the countryside has been restored, and the inhabitants are secure because there are no threats from anyone. Then, at the end of the millennial kingdom, Gog will marshal forces to converge upon Israel like a storm from the north, east, south, and west to attack Jesus and His government in Jerusalem. Ezekiel's description of the promised land does not match the situation in Israel today, as the land is replete with checkpoints and walls and homes are fortified. There is no way to reconcile Ezekiel's narrative of the promised land with the present condition, and that means that these events must take place in the future. As we correlate the book of Ezekiel with the book of Revelation, it becomes clear that Ezekiel's prophecy from 2,590 years ago has yet to be fulfilled and won't occur until the end of the millennial kingdom. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1873. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.